Hi everyone, and welcome to today's webinar. I'm Michaela Lozano, and we'll be discussing Kubernetes 101, Intro to Kubernetes Namespaces, Workloads, and Architecture. Today's presenter is Oleg Chinukin, CTO at Kubler. If you have any questions, please post them in the chat and we'll make sure to address them. Okay, let's go ahead and get started.
Okay, thank you, Michaela, for the introductions, and welcome everybody to our webinar. We just said, so it's going to be essentially a walk through the basics of Kubernetes, so introduction into how Kubernetes works, into Kubernetes architecture, and how it's used. I will also show how you work with Kubernetes command line tools like kubectl, and talk about some of the tools that you can use to deploy Kubernetes, both for development and production. So let's get started. But before we actually go to Kubernetes, a couple of words about why we are running this webinar and who we are. So as Michaela said, I am CTO at a company called Kubler, and we work on a Kubernetes management platform. So we are part of CNCF ecosystem. You can find Kubler here in the platform section. And this picture, the set of projects and components that comprise CNCF cloud native ecosystem and Kubernetes related ecosystem, is actually one of the reasons why Kubler exists, so why we decided to develop Kubler. So Kubler is a tool that allows you to deploy Kubernetes across different environments in the data centers or in the cloud using unified architecture. And that provides you with integrated tools in pretty much every category from this picture. So it allows IT operations teams to quickly start working with Kubernetes and quickly start providing essentially Kubernetes within their Kubernetes platforms, within their organizations for their developers, without actually sacrificing operations capabilities. So we built into Kubler centralized control plane where you manage multiple clusters from the same place in different spaces, centralized log collection where you see all the metrics from all the clusters under the same dashboard, centralized it was actually a centralized monitoring with different metrics from different clusters, and centralized log collection where all logs are available in the same database, access to dashboard, et cetera, et cetera. So why we are running these webinars about Kubernetes is because essentially what we see in our clients often is that the main barrier for Kubernetes adoption is not essentially learning tools that allow you to operate Kubernetes, but actually learning Kubernetes and learning what cloud native architectures can help you with and how to deploy them and how to integrate them into your existing processes, which is why we created this series of 101 and 201 webinars. This is essentially the most generic of them, talking about Kubernetes in general, but we have also a set of seminars or webinars talking about more specific areas like scheduling and Kubernetes, controllers and Kubernetes, RBAC and access control. So you can check it on our website in the on-demand video section. So without further ado, let's start our Kubernetes journey. So first of all, what Kubernetes is and what it is not. So Kubernetes is a system for managing and orchestrating containerized applications in cluster, and most importantly, distributed containerized applications. So it allows you to take a set of virtual or physical machines and transform them into a cluster which can run your containers. Big benefits of Kubernetes that made it so popular are that it's so portable. It works in pretty much every cloud, in private or public infrastructure, on hybrid environments, in multi-cloud environments. It's very efficient, written in Go. It's extensible, pretty much every aspect of your container management infrastructure can be configured. And if some of the infrastructure components are not supported by the Kubernetes core, it will be supported by some plugin or module working with Kubernetes. It creates a self-healing environment for you. So essentially Kubernetes is able to recover after infrastructure failures. It can move your containers between nodes when those fails. Scalable and reliable, well documented. There is a lot of documentation and training materials and community support. And of course, commercial support available. And it's open source. It's based on MIT license, commercially friendly license with large and active community. We see it being used in pretty much every area today. I mentioned already different environments where it works. And we see it used in data science and machine learning applications, digital transformation, microservices, Internet of Things on the edge, pretty much everywhere. So flexible it is. Having said that, so let's talk about architecture of Kubernetes and how it actually works. So first of all, I already mentioned the most important notion of Kubernetes is a cluster. Cluster which consists of a set of nodes. Each node is a physical or virtual machine, and in most cases, nodes are split into two large categories, worker nodes and master nodes or API nodes. So worker nodes are those machines which actually run your application load, your application containers. So we have them here on the right side. And master nodes are nodes that run system components of Kubernetes called API server, controllers, controller manager, and metadata storage for that cluster. Of course, there can be variations of that architecture. Those master nodes may not necessarily be actual physical nodes or virtual nodes, but rather a logical API server for Kubernetes in more complicated deployments and maybe some customized Kubernetes implementations like those that cloud vendors run. But in most cases, when you run your own Kubernetes cluster, it will be a separate physical or virtual machine. So let's go through different components and see how they work together. And we'll start with worker nodes, where the most important element of Kubernetes architecture is kubelet. So kubelet is a single binary service which runs on every worker node and which is responsible for that node in the Kubernetes cluster. It constantly communicates with the master, with the Kubernetes API, checks which containers should and should not run on the worker node which this kubelet serves, and how they should be configured. And it is responsible for turning that into life, essentially, making sure that those specified containers are actually running, started in a container runtime on this node, or stopped or reconfigured, et cetera, et cetera. So another worker node component is a kubeproxy. So kubeproxy is essentially distributed IP tables and FS tables based proxy and load balancer that is responsible for configuring network stack on worker nodes so that pods, containers running in your cluster can actually talk to each other over network. When we are looking at master, one of the most important components there is, of course, distributed watchable storage for cluster metadata. It's where Kubernetes holds, stores its information about which nodes are part of the cluster, which containers were asked or requested to be run on those on that cluster, and a lot of other service information. In most cases, this storage is an etcd cluster, it's a open source key value storage system, and that etcd cluster is provides essentially storage for Kubernetes API server, and API server is the heart of Kubernetes. So it provides a CRUD REST interface API for external and internal clients. So Kubernetes API server is the only component which directly talks to the storage. Every other component in Kubernetes and outside of Kubernetes talks to Kubernetes through this API. And API presents to the outside world and to inside components the view of Kubernetes cluster as a set of objects. And we'll talk about those objects in a few slides. Other master components include scheduler and controller manager. So scheduler is essentially a component that implements a core functionality of Kubernetes related to scheduling pods or containers to worker nodes. So when a client creates a new pod, in most cases, client does not specify on which node this pod should run. And that's when scheduler starts working and decides where to put that pod. And so that's what scheduler does. And another component is controller manager. We'll talk about controllers in Kubernetes. So controllers manager implements the logic behind those controllers. So we can see in a few slides how it all works together, but we need to focus on security first. So this API, Kubernetes API, is not open to the whole world, of course. Kubernetes implements strong enterprise-grade authentication and authorization system, which is very pluggable, again, extensible, supports different modes of authentication and authorization, and most useful is role-based access control. Again, I mentioned already, we have a whole webinar talking specifically about role-based access control in Kubernetes. And transport security is essentially enabled in Kubernetes by default. So every component that talks over the network with other components does so using TLS, transport layer security, with strong encryption, keys, certificates, et cetera, clients, external clients to Kubernetes, well, most well-known are kubectl. That's a command line utility which lets you manage Kubernetes clusters and applications running there. We'll deal with it in this presentation today. And Kubernetes dashboard, a simple web UI for Kubernetes clusters that can show you those or visualize those objects representable through Kubernetes API. Let's see how a simple orchestration scenario works with a running Kubernetes cluster. So user, usually using a kubectl command line tool, creates a new deployment object via REST API in Kubernetes database. And we'll see the example there. So let's do it right now. I have a cluster available out there, so I can run kubectl command get nodes kubectl, of course. So we see that we have this command line tool configured for my cluster with 5 nodes, one of which is master. You can see it here. And we can use our kubectl utility to create a actual deployment object in this cluster. So it may be done like this. For example, you see I run kubectl. Here I have an alias for that to save keystrokes. I use apply command for kubectl. I specify that I will take the Kubernetes object definition from an input stream, and I immediately specify that Kubernetes object definition. So we'll talk a bit about this definition in next slide. But for now, suffice it to say that I'm creating a deployment object or object of type deployment with a name dp1. And this deployment object describes three pods using this pod template. So, and let's just do that. We'll see we can run command get deployment, and we'll see that our object named dp1 was just created, and we can actually check if it resulted in new pods or new containers running. If we run a command kubectl get pods, we see that there are three pods, just as I asked here, started just half a minute ago, according to this deployment specification. So let's go back to our presentation and see how it worked. So kubectl called Kubernetes API, and this call resulted in creating a new object in the storage and in the database. So next thing that happens, controller manager component, which constantly watches Kubernetes API, notices that, hey, there is a new deployment object, but there are no pods for that deployment object. And this deployment object in its specification says that there should be three pods. So controller manager actually creates those pod objects in the database. But it doesn't mean that they immediately appear here as actual running containers. This is the responsibility of the scheduler. So scheduler notices that three new pods appeared in the database, and next thing that happens is it also notices that those pods are not actually scheduled to any specific node. So they don't have in their specification on which node they should run. So scheduler uses its algorithms to calculate which nodes are best to run those pods. And again, we have another webinar talking specifically about how this algorithms works, how scheduler decides which nodes to use for each specific pod. But the result is that scheduler marks in each of those pods on which node this pod should run. And then that's where kubelets take the baton. So they notice on each worker node, respective kubelet notices that a new pod appeared in the Kubernetes API, which is assigned to its corresponding worker node. And that's when kubelet actually starts the container according to that specification. That happens very quickly. As you could see, a few seconds after I created the deployment, those pods were already running. Another thing that you can do is to use other other clients and Kubernetes dashboard, web UI, I mentioned, is another type of client which allows you to visualize your load and your cluster in a nice form. Like here we can see that we have our deployment, which was just deployed 3 minutes ago. We already have three pods running, and we can easily even perform some operations like scaling. Let's say that we want to scale it up to 6 pods. You see, I changed the number of pods in the deployment, and it just took a few seconds to add those pods and make them actually running. And we can see that those pods were placed on different nodes in our cluster. And just as easy, we can scale it down And we can also talk about auto-scaling. So a lot of whatever we can do manually, we can do through API or command line. And so, or automated in any way we like. And just a few seconds after we scaled it down, we see that the result is a scaled down application. Now let's talk about, this is all good and great when your cluster is already running, but how you deploy your Kubernetes cluster. There are numerous frameworks and tools that allow you to do that. It's just important to remember that you should pick and choose those tools according to your business requirements and business goals. So maybe the first thing that you can see out there for Kubernetes deployment are cloud-managed solutions. Every major public cloud provider has their own Kubernetes implementation, like AWS EKS, Azure AKS, Google GKE, etc., etc. So they have their benefits if you only live with that provider. So it's relatively easy to start with each of them. They are integrated into each corresponding cloud. One of the problems with them is that they are specific to each of those providers. So if you have multi-cloud environment or hybrid environment, it will become much more difficult or even impossible in certain situations to use them the way you need in multi-cloud environment or a hybrid environment. You can use a development and testing framework like Kind and Minikube. So, and we'll talk about them in a second. So those usually much lighter weight solutions that you can use on a local machine to, for development and testing. There are multi-platform vendor independent tools category and Kubler falls into that category, as well as Rancher, for example, or some other tools. And for the purposes of this demo, I'll show you how you can quickly start playing with Kubernetes using Kind. So Kind is just a single binary utility, which allows you to run sort of virtual Kubernetes cluster in your Docker environment on a local machine. So you can just download this Kind executable on Linux and run command Kind create cluster. And it will just take maybe under a minute to start a few, or actually by default one container, which will pose as a Kubernetes, as a full-fledged Kubernetes node. Of course, Kind cluster in some minor aspects and details will be different from a real life hardware or virtual hardware Kubernetes cluster. But in most aspects relevant for development and testing of application deployment on Kubernetes cluster, it will be exactly the same as any Kubernetes cluster you can deploy through other tools. And it's a great benefit. It's very lightweight. So it's just a bunch of containers running on your local machine, essentially. You can kill it, create it in a matter of minutes, and you can use it in your automated tests, unit tests, whatever you like, or just your research work. for my actual examples that I show today, and I already did that, I will use our Kubler demo. So we have a Kubler platform deployed in vSphere-based data center. We use it for demos, and if you want to us to run a demo, it's very easy to schedule it through our website. I can show you the functionality of Kubler, including already mentioned centralized log collection, monitoring, access control, identity management integration, etc., etc. So, and for the purposes of this demo, I will use this five-node cluster which I set up, and I already showed you the dashboard that can be opened again from Kubler UI into that cluster. So you can see, for example, that yes, it's the same cluster, those five nodes, this deployment that we just started there. So I set up a kubectl command line environment to work with that cluster, and we'll interchangeably use this command line and dashboard UI to see what happens in with our examples. So again, you can test Kubler with just by running it in a container as well. But the cluster you will deploy after you started that container will have to go into some either in the cloud, in one of the supported Kubler clouds, like AWS Azure Google Cloud, or vSphere infrastructure through vSphere API. But also using that container, you can deploy full Kubler platform with centralized monitoring and log collection. So we talked about different clients that you can use to manage your Kubernetes cluster. You can also use REST API for integrations, web dashboards. So let's talk about objects that you need to know to at least start working with Kubernetes. So there are two large categories. So you can loosely separate those objects into primitives, the basic objects like namespace, node, pod, service, etc., and controllers. So those objects that don't represent a specific set of changes in the environment, but rather tell Kubernetes that something needs to be done with primitive objects. And every object in Kubernetes have some things in common. So all of them have name and potentially namespace. Some of the objects in Kubernetes are global, other namespace. We'll talk about that in a few seconds. Most of the objects have spec section in their object definition. So in here you see an example of object that represents pod, or we'll use it interchangeably with the word container in this presentation. So these objects usually are serialized in text form as YAML files, and this is exactly what you see here, a YAML representation of this object. It has always a type, in this case it's pod. It has a metadata section which includes name, namespace, set of labels, annotations, optional labels and annotations. Spec section, which includes actual definition of the object. And in case of pod, it is, for example, list of containers of which this pod consists, and some additional parameters. And often objects include, not often, but always when you deploy an object to a Kubernetes cluster, status section appears there, which describes it. Its runtime status. So we can check how it looks like when we open our one of the pods. We can click on this icon in Kubernetes UI, and we will see this pod definition. We will see this metadata section. We will see the spec section. We will see the status section, which shows how this pod was actually mapped and deployed onto our infrastructure, statuses of different containers. If there are any errors, they will be reflected here, pod IP address, and a number of other parameters that may be useful to identify what's happening with this specific container. So, talking about specific objects, the most basic and the most important is namespace. So let's see, in our dashboard, we can see that there is a list of namespaces. And namespace is essentially a bucket for Kubernetes objects. Each namespace contains its own objects, or doesn't contain them at all. Like I can switch to cube system namespace. That's a special namespace that includes various system components important for the whole cluster function. And we see a lot of containers running there. While in this default namespace, so default namespace is usually a namespace where you start, where kubectl will create objects if you don't specify namespace. And you will see those pods that we just deployed. So we can run kubectl get ns. That's an abbreviation for namespace, and we'll see all the namespaces in our cluster. We can run kubectl with any kubectl command with dash n parameter specifying a namespace, and it will give us objects from that specific namespace. Like for example, here we are asking kubectl to show us pods in kubler namespace, and here are the pods in kubler namespace. If we change kubler to default, we will see only pods running in our default namespace. You can create new namespaces, you can delete namespaces if you have permissions to do that. Namespaces are also a unit of access control, so you can have different access rights within namespaces. You can even not be able to see certain namespaces. So this way you can provide multiple teams with different workspaces within a single cluster. And namespaces can be also used as quota and limit sources. So you essentially may limit the number of resources that users can use within a certain namespace. Next object, important object of the cluster is nodes. And nodes is something that you rarely change by yourself. Nodes just reflect actual virtual physical nodes of which your cluster consists. So, and we already saw how nodes are shown. If you run kubectl get nodes, kubectl get nodes, we'll see all the nodes in our cluster. By the way, instead of get, you often, in most cases, you can use describe command, subcommand, which gives you much more information about each of the objects that is returned by get command. Or alternatively, you can ask get, use get command, but ask kubectl to output information in, for example, YAML format. And here it is. I will use paged output. Now, instead of just the list of nodes in my cluster, I can see their actual YAML representation in that cluster in all the nitty-gritty details. Next object, basic object is pod. So pod is essentially a group of containers, and let's see how it is deployed. So we already talked about the lifecycle. So pod is first created without actually putting it on a specific node. This is how pod definition may look like in a YAML format. After scheduler decides that it should be placed on a certain node, the pod gets usually started, or containers from that pod get usually started on that node if there are no issues. And pod is assigned a unique virtual IP address within the cluster. So those IP addresses are actually what pods use to talk to each other over the network, over the cluster network. Another important notion about the pod is that pods are immutable. So after you created and started pod, it cannot be changed, it cannot be moved, it can only terminate and be deleted. So when you hear that someone is talking about pods being restarted or moved between nodes, so what actually happens there is that pods are stopped and removed from one node and started with the same definition on the other node. So technically speaking, those are different pods that are just restarted on a different node. Another basic primitive object in Kubernetes is volumes. And that's essentially an abstraction that allows you to represent different types of block and file storage and mount them to your containers. And different types are supported out of the box, like, for example, AWS, Azure Block Store, Google, of course, Google Disks, NFS shares, GlasterFS, Ceph, and dozens more. Plus, there are a number of pods that, or number of types of storage that are supported through external Kubernetes plugins, so-called CSI plugins or container storage interface plugins. So we'll not focus on that in this presentation, but we have examples of using some advanced external storage in some of our webinars, again, on our website. If you want to check it, please welcome. Most important part about pods and volumes is that, well, persistent volume in Kubernetes is an abstraction that represents an external file storage, and you can use that abstraction, that object in via Kubernetes API to tell Kubernetes that that storage should be mounted to a pod when the pod is started. Next type of objects that we want that we'll talk about today is config maps and secrets. So config maps and secrets are very similar. So they are just essentially objects that contain a set of key values, key value pairs, and they are used to configure your application. So you put a bunch of configuration parameters into config map and then map them onto either environment variables in your container or temporary files in your containers. And the same works for secrets. So the difference is only that secrets are used by convention to pass more critical information like passwords, private keys, tokens, et cetera, et cetera. And Kubernetes is much more careful about storing them. You can actually ask Kubernetes to encrypt secrets in the database. Kubernetes guarantees that it's never saved other than in its etcd storage on persistent stores, etc., etc. Next set of objects is services. So essentially, services represent represent a stable endpoint for a group of pods. So I already talked that when you start pods, pod gets each pod gets unique address, and when your pod dies and get restarted on a different node, for example, it gets a different address. So how do you find those pods to connect to them? And this is where service come into play. So service is a logical object, a sort of logical distributed load balancer, and which has its own single IP address. And when you connect to that IP address, you will actually be redirected to one of the pods backing that service. And those pods can come and go. The service will correspondingly change its set of backing addresses and always forward your requests to healthy pods that exist in its backend. So, and as I said, service is a logical construct. So it, whenever you create a service object in Kubernetes API, kubeproxy component reconfigures IP tables on NF tables on each worker node so that they start forwarding requests to that stable IP address to one of the pods in the set of backing pods. And the last set of objects we'll talk about is controllers, and we already saw one of them in action, deployment. When we created the deployment, not only that object was created, but as a result, a set of pods was created. And There are other deployments or other controllers that work similarly, but with a little bit different semantics. So for example, daemon sets are used to create a pod instance on every node of your cluster. So when you add nodes, pods will be started automatically based on the daemon set template. When you remove nodes, they will be removed, et cetera, et cetera. Stateful sets are used to give some additional capabilities in terms of persistent volume management and assignment to a group of pods. Jobs used to run a set of one-time jobs in your cluster through pods. So essentially when you create a new job, a pod will be run, which will implement, which will realize sort of a set of actions that you want to be realized, but will not be restarted if it terminates successfully. And ingress is another important component that allows you to manage incoming traffic. They work very well together with services, but while services implement much lower level traffic management, L4 and L3 in terms of network stack hierarchy, so ingresses work on level 7 on application level. So ingress are essentially HTTP, HTTPS reverse proxy rules, abstractions expressed in form of Kubernetes objects. So if with services you work with essentially IP addresses, with ingresses you work with virtual host names and paths. So with ingress rules, you can say, hey, I want all HTTP requests coming to this with this host name and with this HTTP path be forwarded to that service. And requests with that other domain name or host name to be forwarded to another service. So there is a number of things that we don't have to talk about in details during this presentation. Things like how node labels and pod labels are used to implement pod scheduling or customize pod scheduling on different nodes. Things like pod affinity and anti-affinity rules, node affinity and anti-affinity rules. We didn't go into a lot of details of how you implement persistent storage, scaling, auto scaling, a number of topics on how Kubernetes can be customized and adjusted to different environments and portability. So some of those again topics are covered in our other webinars. I suggest you to check them and. If you want to dig deeper into how Kubernetes works. But I hope that in this webinar, I was able to show how much easier application management becomes and how much more portable it becomes, and at least explain some of the basics of Kubernetes architecture. And I think now we are open to questions.
Yes, so we do have a few questions from the audience. So we'll go ahead and start with this one. Is it possible to specify on which node a pod should run?
Yes, so it's a special case of all these pod affinity, anti-affinity rules, et cetera, et cetera. So you can specify essentially using those labels a subset of nodes on which pods a pod should be scheduled, and this subset can be a set of one node. Like you can put a specific label on a specific node and tell that your pod needs to run on nodes with that label. Alternatively, you can directly specify in the pod a node on which it should run, although this is discouraged because you want to separate your application definition from your infrastructure definition. better alternative is to use those affinity and anti-affinity rules that allow you to specify either soft or hard constraints on which nodes your pod can run. So for example, if your pod includes containers with Linux AMD64 architecture, you can use those constraints to only limit this pod to run on corresponding nodes, not to be scheduled on Windows nodes, for example, if you have a hybrid cluster.
Okay. And then how do you deploy an application with multiple different components on Kubler?
Yes, I think first of all, so yes, Kubler is not that relevant here in the sense that Kubler is Kubernetes management system, but it doesn't really change how you work with those Kubernetes clusters you manage through Kubler. So you, with Kubler, you can create a new cluster in pretty much any environment through UI or through API. But after this cluster is created, you just use standard tools, standard kubectl tools, for example, to deploy your applications. Now, the second part of the question is how you deploy multi-component application on Kubernetes. And this is a good question because I only showed a single deployment object creation, and single deployment object only can include pod of one type. But in most cases in real life, your application consists of maybe dozens components, each of different type, and each maybe have to scale differently, separately, each has its own configuration, et cetera, et cetera. So you can either create a lot of files with deployment manifests there, each for your different component and apply and deploy it to your Kubernetes cluster. But of course, much better way would be to create a single module which includes all your different deployments, and there are tools that allow you to combine multiple Kubernetes objects into a single module. One of them is Customize, which actually became part of kubectl some time ago. Another one, very well known and very widely used, is Helm, where you can create a number of manifests for Kubernetes objects, template them, which is very important, and combine them into a single package, and then deploy them as a single package together, providing some additional parameters to customize their deployment in different environments.
Okay, awesome. Well, unfortunately, we don't have enough time for any other questions, but thank you, Oleg, for this wonderful presentation, and thank you everyone for joining today's webinar. Please feel free to reach out with questions or topic suggestions at the email provided, and we hope that you can join us next time. Thank you, Oleg.
Thank you.